Thank you. Thank you. Questions and just to give you an example, one of the questions was, is glaucoma in rural India different from the glaucoma that we see in urban areas? Which then again brings us to the question that somebody actually asked me once, can the practice of glaucoma in an urban environment be replicated in a rural environment? So these are some of the interesting questions which comes out, and this is the last webinar organized by the Glaucoma Society of India with its current office bearers. And before we move on to the webinars, I'd like to thank all the people who have been involved, the speakers, the discussants, the participants, all of you who have participated in joining in. And I'd like to thank my team, Dr. B.K. Nayak, who's been the secretary, and Dr. Manav Deep Singh, who's the treasurer of the Glaucoma Society of India. Dr. Nayak, any words, because we are now closing the GSI series of webinars, there's a lot of things to be done as far as elections and the online annual meeting is concerned. So any quick words from your side before we get the ball rolling?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Devendra. Good evening, everyone. I think only one thing I have to request every members, because please update your email ID, mobile number and addresses on the website of Glaucoma Society of India website, your membership details, because that will help you in two things, because in 10 days from now, we are going to send the list to, because all of us are entitled to get free access to Journal of Glaucoma. So unless your details are there, you will not be able to get it through. So that is number one. So please update it as early as possible, because in I think 9 days from now, we will be sending it to the World Glaucoma Association, the entire list, number one. Number two, also please, please update your data, because that will also help you to vote online. Otherwise, you will not be able to vote online, and after the deadline, we will not be updating those numbers or those addresses. We will be updating, but that will not be utilized for the election purposes once we have given the detail to the election vendor. So therefore, please do it. And I really thank everyone for giving me full support for the entire 2 years of my tenure. Thank you. Yeah, so proceed now, because I don't want to delay any further. Thank you.
Our first speaker is Dr. Madhu Bhaduria. Ma'am, can we have your slides on? Nageshwar?
Yes, Devin. I don't know why my video is off. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you all see
your
slides?
Slides are coming on. They are coming on. Yep. Ma'am. They are coming on.
Right, right. So then we start right away.
They are on, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, so good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's really nice being with GSI, and thank you, GSI. With this, I'll start as a first opening batch person. So ophthalmologists are most confused about glaucoma diagnosis and treatment, and history is the most neglected part of it. Actually, history taking is not in the beginning or the end. It starts and it seamlessly progresses to the end when the patient leaves the clinic. So why do we need really history when it's an asymptomatic disease?
Thank you.
Because there are loads of pitfalls in the measurements. But why we really need history is because there are lots of associated risk factors which impact progression. Other than that, systemic diseases affect glaucoma. Systemic drugs interact with anti-glaucoma medications. And lifestyle is very important for the initiation of the therapy. I think there's some disturbance coming in between of the sound. Can we have the mics off? So sources of the patients, the detection in glaucoma clinic is in the routine, referrals, symptomatic patients. But what is really most important is the risk factors. So if we see the literature, the strong evidence is with age. But is it same for all the age groups? No, it's not. The people who are above 40 years of age, between 50 years are only 1%. But those who are above 80 years of age are 10%. So therefore, we need to really look at it carefully. But where we make a mistake, we don't look at the people who are frail and they're aging premature. Now, these are the people who are actually aging before the age, and they come in the same category of the older people. The disc and IOP would be talked about by somebody else. So moving to important serious risk factor is ocular surgery. We say retina surgery. It means not only any surgery in the retina. Is there silicone oil? Are there buckles? If it's cataract, AFIC, pseudophake, SICS or phaco, is it intact or gone? Or are we dealing with strabismus? Have the vertical top muscles have been touched? If it's a patient who's undergone refractive surgery, pachymetry becomes extremely important, because our IOP would not be correct if we don't take that into account. And most important is failed glaucoma surgery. It's very important in the history to let a person know exactly as to what were the causes why the surgery has failed so that the next surgery could be better. A mistake three is about the family history. Family history is not same. If it's a parent to child, the odds ratio is only 1:1.3, whereas if it's a sibling, is 3 times more. And diabetes is twice more, this thing is higher than the normal people. Mistake four is refractive errors. In the old study, myopes progressed, 60% of myopes progressed to POAG. And out of that, also in another Chinese study, people who had myopia of more than 6 diopter produced progressed a lot more. Falls, poor dark adaptation, fluctuation of the vision are other some of the complaints. Now we look at this big list of systemic diseases. I won't be talking about these diseases, but what I want you to remember is that people with glaucoma have loads of systemic diseases and they all have implications. And similarly, the drugs that we use are also loads, and each one of them has got some or the other kind of an impact. Just one simple example is hypertension. We just don't need to know it's a hypertension alone. The type of drugs we're using, time of taking drugs, and control of blood pressure. Drugs like beta blockers taken orally will affect the IOP drop of the topical beta blockers by 15%. And if a hypertensive patient is taking drug at night, then there may be possible NTG. The picture you are seeing is of a person who was in a year ago was a suspect. In 1 year's time, with best controlled IOPs and DVTs, progressed into glaucoma because he was having nocturnal hypertension. And the other way is anti-glaucoma drop. If a patient is taking beta blocker, then asthma can aggravate, and a patient of IHD can go to into bradyarrhythmias and heart block as well. So systemic diseases, other things, a claustrophobic patient may be a nightmare for the surgeons. Psychotropic and GI drugs also can lead to PACG because of the acute attack, because of the pupillary dilatation effect. Patients who have strokes and all, they have ample field effects which may mimic glaucoma. And this is a picture of a girl who was referred to me for asymmetric cups. She was just a young girl with normal IOP. And diagnosis is written on the face. The differential tonometry was showing 12 millimeters more. She was a case of thyroid. So coming to initiation of therapy, history of pregnancy is very important if we are dealing with people, because now pregnancy is also happening at the late age. If you are giving brimonidine to adults, a depression and sleep is important. And for the carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, we all know that they're sulfa cross allergic, but we forget that they potentiate effect of cyclosporin and rigoxin and reduce the effect of OHAs. Prostaglandin, when we start, we think is great, but we must take a history of ocular HSV and uveitis, because in case we do not have that, the patient you are seeing in the picture, this patient came as acute angle crochet glaucoma with deep ACs OU, and examination revealed that it was activation of herpetic uveitis with raised IOPs. Mistake nine is lifestyle. Yoga is very good, and it's really very good these days, but all the yogas where the head goes below the waist increases intraocular pressures. Then loads of people are also drinking loads of water and fluid overloads. That can lead to raised IOP at different times. Instrument blowers, especially the trumpet blowers, their IOP also rises. I think Sagarika did a study with this thing on these people. Then drug abuse, marijuana. This is the only protective drug. It drops the IOP, but it's only an entertainment drug, not recommended. Then another important thing is the profession and the working hours, because if a person has got odd working hours and is a professional traveling a lot, then these people are not able to put their drugs regularly, and they, despite saying that they're putting the drugs, they don't get controlled and they start having progression. Finally, we come to something simple as compliance. The patient, to whatever drugs we subscribe or prescribe, we have to see whether he can afford for long term, and not one day that you give Xylitol and next time is Stimulon. So for the continuity, the drug should be affordable. Then the drug should be available also locally. A soldier in Ladakh will not be able to find, actually a Xylitol may find beta blocker. The same thing is able to instill the drops. His support is there, or the patient can put himself. And also the last thing is to come for follow-up. And finally, we must ensure that whatever we have told the patient, has the patient been able to follow or not been able to follow? Because unless until a patient follows, the treatment is not worth anything. And finally, we should search, hunt, document, and all the relevant history, because I really want to look at the picture. What looks like a partridge is actually a baby hen. And if you look at it and look at the head of it, there is a little clue that is the top thing is coming out. So that is what we have been glaucoma. We got to really search. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Bhadauria. Our next speaker is Professor Manavdeep Singh, who is going to talk to us about measuring the intraocular pressure.
Thank you, Dr. Sood. I'll share my screen. Hello, can you hear me and see my screen also?
Yes, Manavdeep, we can hear you and we can see the screen as well.
Top 10 mistakes in measuring the intraocular pressure that we need to avoid. The key to diagnostic equipment, any diagnostic equipment, is precision and accuracy. Accuracy is primarily a function of the equipment and tells you how accurately that pressure is measured in comparison to the barometric pressure. And the precision is the repeatability, which is primarily a function of the patient or the observer factors. We can see that Goldman Appreciation Tonometer has got best of these. The top 10 mistakes include the informed patient. We should have the patient informed. We'll go into the details of everything. Infected or injured, either patient or the instrument, the appropriate equipment to be used in an appropriate condition, touch up to the eyelashes, the Myers, the central corneal thickness, astigmatism, first contact procedure, cleaning, disinfection, and calibration. So these are the topics under which we are going to discuss. And an uninformed patient is scared, will not be cooperative, he will blink excessively and move the head. We need to avoid contact procedures in infected eyes, injured eyes, and also in case our instrument, which is going to touch the eye, is faulty or injured. The appropriate equipment to be used under various circumstances, and the present is the gold standard, is the Goldman Appreciation Tonometer, as all of you know. However, we do have certain alternatives under certain specific conditions, like for post-curator effective, dynamic contour is the best, although it is very inconvenient to use.
Dr. Manavdeep, I'm sorry to interrupt. Your slides are not coming on.
Not coming
your
on?
Slides are not, they are not there.
Recording is on.
Can you see now?
No.
What is this?
So what we'll do is let's go on to the next. Can you just do the screen share and try once quickly? So what we'll do is we'll go on to the next.
Okay. Go to the next person.
Next speaker, and I'm going to request Dr. Medha Prabhudesai to talk to us about the mistakes in optic disc evaluation. Dr. Prabhudesai, can you share your slide content, please?
Yes, Bhagisha, sure,
can
sir.
You make the changes?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Are they visible?
No.
Yes, they are visible. Thanks.
Okay, so I'll start now.
Yes, please start.
I'll be starting how to avoid mistakes in ONH evaluation. Most important is that you have to do a careful examination and keep an open mind while evaluating the optic nerve head. Before going into the mistakes, we should know how a normal ONH looks like, how the cup looks like, otherwise it's not possible. We should be able to find out neuroretinal rim, which is the area between the cup margin and the disc margin. We should be well aware of what are the signs which are there in glaucoma for optic nerve head. So after this, we have to pay attention to the disc size, not to make the mistake, of labeling a small disc or a large disc as having glaucoma, because there is a wide variation in normal population and this affects the apparent neuroretinal rim. Large discs definitely have large cups and should not be labeled as glaucoma. Even if there are large discs, we have to find out signs of glaucoma like disc asymmetry, cup asymmetry, vascular asymmetry, NRR thinning, bayoneting, and then only label them as glaucoma. Small disc, is it difficult to see the NRR? Definitely observe RNFL and find out if there is any RNFL defect. Deep cups, obviously, it is difficult to say whether they have glaucoma, but if the NRR and RNFL is totally normal, then you should give importance to that and not the cupping, because it can be physiologic cupping. Disc asymmetry can be in disc size, which can lead to asymmetry in the cupping. So we should not label these patients as having glaucoma. But if the disc asymmetry is like this, there is thinning of NRR, asymmetry in the NRR and cup, and even in the vessel cores, other signs of glaucoma are present, obviously this is glaucoma. Vertical enlargement of the cup can be seen normally in vertically oval disc, but if it is there along with thinning of NRR and RNFL defects, then this is definitely a glaucomatous patient. Moderate myopia is definitely a diagnostic dilemma. We should document these ONH, investigate further before labeling them as glaucomatous and starting treatment. Myopic tilted disc can be mistaken as thin NRR and labeled as glaucoma, but documentation and investigations would help in these patients. Tilted discs were seen labeling them as having thinning of NRR or beta atrophy, so this has to be avoided totally. Focal notching is a definitive sign of glaucoma and it is very specific, because we know that tumors, inflammations, infections or ischemia cannot notch a nerve, and this has to be documented. And whenever there is notching, we have to check for corresponding RNFL defect and then only say that this patient has glaucoma. Next is, you have to differentiate pallor and cupping. Pallor is not glaucoma. So if cupping is more than pallor, you can label this patient as a glaucoma. But if the cupping is less and pallor is much more, then 100% it is not glaucoma. Rim pallor in glaucoma is very rare. If it is a sectoral pallor along with attenuation of vessel, you have to think of AON and not glaucoma. And otherwise, you need to investigate neurologically these patients to see what is going on. Pallor more, we know that it's not glaucoma now, but we have to look for other ocular signs, because there can be CRAO or any vascular occlusions in that. Pallor more than cupping obviously can be a primary optic atrophy or retinitis pigmentosa or sine pigmento. So we have to keep these findings and these signs in mind. Coming to vascular signs, disc hemorrhage, if it is in the disc, can be due to vascular causes and can be NVD. But disc hemorrhage, which crosses the disc margin and corresponds to RNFL striations, can be a proper disc hemorrhage of glaucoma. Bayoneting can be seen in patients with deep cupping, but if it is associated with thinning of NRR, then it can be glaucomatous. Similarly, a circumlinear vessel can be seen normally here, but if there is a bearing of circumlinear vessel, it can be glaucoma. Beta atrophy again can be seen in patients with moderate myopia. And if it's also seen in patients with moderate GON, where there is thinning of NRR, or extensive in patients with advanced GON. So obviously, when you see beta atrophy, you should not label this patient as having glaucoma, because it can be seen normally. The most important is, do not forget RNFL defects. Subtle RNFL defects can be seen better with red free light, and we have to document or draw these findings. Whenever the apparently normal ONH is there, there can be RNFL defects and hence should not be missed before diagnosing or labeling these patients as having not glaucoma. Obviously, you have to watch for progression, because there you can see the signs how the disc hemorrhage disappears or if there is a development of subtle RNFL defect. Our glaucoma patients can have comorbid situations. So if the patient comes up with some other sign or symptom, you have to see carefully other eye also, because glaucoma can exist with other comorbid conditions. And these are the signs which obviously it is not possible for us to say whether they have glaucoma or not. So we need documentation and keep watching the disc further. So documentation, obviously don't forget to have your color photographs, stereo photographs, and even your drawings on your OPD papers. So careful evaluation with an open mind is important. Note the disc size. NRR is important and not CD. Check for pallor cup discrepancy. Find and observe vascular signs. Evaluate RNFL defects. Note the signs of progression. Keep a high level of suspicion when the findings are atypical. And remember that a patient may have more than one disease. Obviously, keep in mind that everything that looks like glaucoma may not be a glaucoma. Thank you for your kind attention.
Yeah, next one should share the screen.
Our next speaker is...
Should I try?
Yeah. Dr. Manadeep, are you speaking? Are your slides...
Yeah.
Yes.
Your slides,
is it okay?
We are not
can
seeing
you see
still.
Still not seeing?
No.
Yes, they have come. They have come.
So now Manadeep,
should I start with the beginning?
Your time is reduced by 1.5 minutes.
Okay, sir.
Start.
I'll just go from here. 10 mistakes. The informed patient, avoid infected or injured eyes or injured instrument. Appropriate equipment to be used. Eyelashes not to be touched. The myopes to be taken carefully. Central corneal thickness, astigmatism, first contact procedure, cleaning and calibration. These are the things to be seen. An uninformed patient is always scared, will not cooperate, will blink excessively and move the head. I have just discussed that infected and injured eyes not to be used. The appropriate instrument is for post-keratorefractive surgery, we use dynamic contour tonometer, although the gold standard is the Goldman appellation tonometer, but dynamic contour tonometer is difficult to use. The NCT is used. It can be used for screening, and I'll not go into the details except that the diseased cornea post PK and contact lens tonopen is a better instrument. So this is these are the various instruments used. So this is that eyelashes should not be touched because they are not anesthetized and induce blinking. About myopes, what are they? They are basically, as you can see this red arrow, they are a tear film on the sides of the flattened area of the cornea. And the amount of fluorescein has a lot of impact. If it is excess, we have to wipe. If it is less, we have to put more fluorescein and tear drops. The thick myopes lead to overestimation, and the thin myopes can lead to underestimation of the intraocular pressure. So what is the correct alignment? When the width of myopes is 1/10 of the diameter, and they lock with inter-equal size and semicircles, they lock at the internal edges. And cardiac pulsations, if you cannot see, that means you are not appropriately measuring the intraocular pressure, so they must be visible. And this is how these are. This is this on the picture on the left shows the centration is okay, but the fluorescent ring is too thick and appellation is too low. That means the pressure inside the eye is more than what you are measuring on the drum. And this is the other way around, and here there is incorrect centration. Slit lamp height observer scope need to be increased. The central corneal thickness affects all currently available tonometers. So high the CCT, it records falsely high intraocular pressure. There are no nomograms, but we should say that that whether it is normal, low or high corneal thickness, this roughly equal, it is 540 is taken as the normal. In future, we might stop using this and we might start considering the corneal elasticity as the more important factor. Central corneal thickness, if it is increased inherently, then it overestimates the IOP, whereas if it is increased because of edema, then it reduces, underestimates the intraocular pressure. If the corneal curvature is irregular, the steep corneas will overestimate and the flat corneas, they underestimate the pressure. It is because the applanated area, if it is elliptical, requires more pressure for applanation. And one should avoid the error. One can avoid the error by aligning the red mark to 43 degrees to the minus axis of the cylinder. Alternatively, it can be taken horizontally and vertically so that the correct measurements can be done and averaged out. So these are the two pictures showing the same thing. The first contact procedure means that if a patient and the patient generally in the glaucoma clinic, they undergo multiple procedures in one day. Contact procedures like tonometry, pachymetry, gonioscopy and possibly axial length as well. So we have to do the intraocular pressure first. Why? Because there can be fall of intraocular pressure due to pressure of instruments and irregularity of the marks. The calibration check is very important for every instrument. However, they are generally internally done, and whereas in Goldman efficient tonometer, we need to check it every 3 to 6 months depending on the age of the equipment. It is done at 3 positions, 0, 2 and 6. And these are the positions and the two sides, it is there on two sides, which is depending on different models of the slit lamps. So this is showing the same thing. And this precise setting of the central mark is very, very important, probably the most important thing in this. Cleaning and disinfection has always been important, but in the COVID-19 era, it is even more important. And disposable tonometer tips and sleeves are available. However, it is not very practical to use because of the cost factor. So for the regular Goldman prism, we need to use, we need to keep it in 0.1% bleach or 3% hydrogen peroxide for 10 minutes. In the morning and evening at the end of the clinic both times, and wash it with distilled water and dry it every time this disinfectant is used. In between the patient, however, we can use isopropyl alcohol. This is how it is done, the pictorial representation of the same. Thus, to summarize, accuracy of intraocular pressure measurement is mainly the function of the equipment, whereas the precision depends mainly on the observer and the patient factors. Goldman is the standard tonometer for measurement of IOP as it stands today, and although not the most preferred instrument for measurement of IOP in corneal disease, thin corneas, or in post-keratorefractive surgery or post-PK. And taking care of these 10 points discussed in this presentation, we can help you to accurately assess, they will help you to assess accurately intraocular pressure, which is the only modifiable factor in the management of glaucoma. Thank you very much. You can see this video in case you like on the YouTube.
Thank you, Dr. Manavdeep. Our next speaker is Dr. Mayuri Khamar, and she is going to talk to us about the mistakes we make when we are assessing angle outflow structures. I think the biggest mistake is when you don't do gonioscopy, and then what are the other mistakes that we make? Over to you, Dr. Khamar. Dr. Khamar, can you please share your screen?
I'm sharing my screen.
Yeah, it's coming on, ma'am. Coming.
Can you see it now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I'm going to talk on some of the mistakes, common mistakes that we can avoid during the assessment of the anterochamber structures. The gonioscopy is the essential tool for the assessment of the anterior chamber angle. It gives us not only the grading, but differential diagnosis, prognosis, as well as the post-procedure assessment also. And it should be a dynamic process. It should be repeated periodically. What are the mistakes that are there with the technique? First, never fill up the well of the gonial lines if you are using Goldman type of gonial lines with the coupling fluid, as the fully filled up well will give you the corneal compression, and that induces the stria on the cornea as well as the deepening of the cornea, which gives you the artificial opening up of the angle. Then watch for the air bubble. After inserting, there is an air bubble. Then tilt the lens towards the bubble to remove them, or take it off and reinsert it. Always counsel the patient, explain the procedure to the patient, because it's very frightening. They do not want to have anything in their eye. So after counseling, put them there on the slit lamp and align the patient at the slit lamp properly. Ask patient to look at the distant object. That will avoid the accommodative reflex and thereby constriction of the pupil. So this mistake should not be there. And then the improper illumination is another mistake. As a beginner, many a times we use the bright light and the full light aperture. So minimize it only with the diffuse light first, with the minimum light see the angle, and the beam should be narrow in the length and should be slightly oblique. A parallelopipe of about 2 mm width should be created, and then view all the mirror with the axis, height of the parallelopipe axis parallel to the axis of the mirror. The most important point here I would like to mention is always avoid light entering in the pupil. Otherwise, there is a constriction of the pupil and it will open up the angle. Another mistake usually seen with the beginner, when they want to buy a lens, particularly residents, fellows, they are asking us which mirror to be used. As a glaucoma specialist, naturally, I would like to use 4 mirror, which is the better option compared to the Goldman large size 1 mirror, 2 mirror or 3 mirror. But if somebody is not going to use this lens often, then one can opt for any of this mirror, as 4 mirror has a long learning curve and you have to be expert while performing it. But the disadvantage of 3 mirror lens, which is a bulky lens, it is difficult to insert in the patient with the small palpebral aperture. So it is always better to try the lens before you buy it. The Goldman type lens, if put on the cornea and lot of pressure is exerted to avoid the bubble in the eye, the interface, this will cause narrowing of the angle because it compresses the limbal area. While 4 mirror lenses, excessive pressure produces corneal strie and artificially opens the angle. So the right, what should be the right amount of the pressure is when air intermittently during the examination, when it is seen between the lens and cornea, that means you are not applying too much of pressure on the cornea. Now the another mistake is happening while documenting or grading the angle and putting the your findings. We should remember that we are using the mirror. So whatever you see is exactly in the opposite, not in the cross or not in the inverted form. So it should be as shown in this figure. For example, the blood vessel seen at the 7 o'clock in the mirror is to be documented at 11 o'clock as shown in this slide. Now, another thing is in the beginning, and many a times we want to see the detail of the all the angles, and then it's a prolonged procedure. So what happens, the cornea becomes edematous, there are folds, and the view becomes compromised. So better to finish this as soon as possible. Always identify the vulnerable eyes where you can have corneal edema formation. Now the last part is that of mistakes in the interpretation. One should be very, very precise about the identification of the anterior chamber structures as shown in this slide. Sampolacis line is a pigmentation on or in front of the Scholbey's line, is often mistaken for the pigmented Scholbey's line. And it is more commonly seen with the pigment dispersion syndrome or the pseudo exfoliation. So in such condition, advice is to form a parallelopipe or a corneal wedge technique, where the apex of this wedge is seen at the Scholbey's line. So you can identify that Sampolacis line is anterior to this Scholbey's line where that apex is. Similarly, sometimes the black pigmentation are at there on the cornea near the angle area as shown in this. So the true angle is behind, but with the help of this apex, you can find out the Scholbey's line is here and densely pigmented, as in the pigmentary glaucoma as you see here. The angle is now to be defined that it is an open angle, but the Scholbey's line is here. Now, if there is a shallow chamber and convex iris, as in occludable angles shown in this slide, many times we don't perform anything else, just putting the lens and you see it and label this as a true angle closure. But it is not so. Above the heel or over the heel is the procedure, can be done by using the same Goldman mirror as a manipulative gonioscopy. Ask patient look into the direction of the mirror and tilt the lens towards the center or towards you. This will allow the light to overpass this bump of the iris and you can see the angle behind. Sometimes we miss the convex iris and confuse the plateau iris configuration has been confused. Here it is shown that if there is a double hump sign like this, it is a plateau iris configuration. And these patients may need more treatment. Only PI is not going to work in this patient.
Time over.
Okay. Should I just pass on? Irish processes are mistaken as a peripheral anterior synechia, and different types of anterior synechia have to be differentiated, and the normal vessel cannot be confused with the multiple vessels of neovascularization. And these are some of the silly mistakes that are there, as this has been diagnosed as angle, which is not true. So these are the take home message, and gonioscopy has to be repeated periodically and clean the lens. Take care and stay safe. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Khamar. That was a very interesting talk. Our next talk is on about avoiding mistakes in perimetry, and the speaker is Dr. Roma Johri. Dr. Johri, yes, please.
Yes. Good evening, everyone. I'll be talking about the top 10 mistakes to avoid in perimetry test and evaluation. The most common mistake which we should avoid, is the discussion with the patient we should do. We should explain the patient why this test is needed and what is the importance in diagnosing as well as in the treatment of glaucoma. This will motivate the patient to do the test. It's important to tell that this test needs periodic repetition and it's not a one-time test. Just like the diabetic patient, we need to check the blood sugar regularly to monitor the control. Defects are not reversible. That's why we have to be very vigilant about it. And it's important to do the test with the same machine at the same place to get the follow-up and to monitor the progression. Explain the procedure in brief in a simple words. Tell the patient that this will measure your central and side vision. Look straight ahead at the steady yellow light. Other lights will flash one at a time to off to the side. Some will be bright, some will be dim, and you are not expected to see all of them because the machine is designed in such a way that no one will see all the light stimuli. Press the button whenever you see the light. Blink normally during the test. Choosing the correct test is the correct thing to do depending on the defect expected, whether we are identifying the defect or we are monitoring the defect. Depending on the patient's general ability, let's suppose if the patient cannot sit for a long time, select a faster test like CitaFast, depending on the psychological makeup and the attention span. The other important thing to be kept in mind is the examination of a patient as a whole. That it should not be missed. Otherwise, it will lead to the unreliable field, the need for repetition, the inconvenience to the patient, and the non-conclusive field to the clinician. For example, in this field, we can see that there are superior defects, which was due to the ptosis. And once the taping was done, the fields was normal. So make sure you are looking for the ptosis, the dermatocalysia, the meiosis, and modify the settings accordingly. Important point is mark the modification what you have done over the field so that next time we should not repeat the same mistake again. Change the size of the stimulus in case of advanced glaucoma. Use a diamond fixation target if the patient has a macular disease. Ensure that the refraction is done on the same day and not to use the previous refraction that can lead to error. The perimetry should always be present inside the room to provide re-education, to give the feedback regarding the test reliability, to encourage the patient to do well, and to tell how much of the test is completed. Most of the patients are elderly. They will have neck problem, back problem, to make sure they are sitting comfortably. And in Humphreys, we can tell the patient to sit on the chair, and the distance of the eye should be around 20 centimeter from the upper level of the headrest, and then ask them to lean forward. This will make them comfortable, and tell them that there should be a direct contact with the device throughout the test. Correct eye patch position is important. If we are using a cord, it should not obstruct the other eye field. And if you are using an adhesive tape, it should allow the normal blinking. Correct lens position with the fixation target is very important. Before starting the test, ask the patient whether you are able to see the fixation target clearly. Make sure the lens should be as close to the eye as possible. Keep in mind about the eyelashes, because the patient on bimatoprost or prostaglandin, they can have the long eyelashes that should not rub against the lens. Tell the patient that the good time to blink is when you press the response button, because the next stimuli will take time to come. To obtain an optimal perimetry, the patient, the clinician, and the perimetrist should work collaboratively as a team. Stopping the field to one test and diagnosing it on the basis of one test is the other mistake we should not do. Remember the learning curve of the patient, and at least 2 to 3 tests are required for accurate and reliable baseline perimetry. Next slide. I'm not able to go to the read the field in a sequential way. Do not jump to the conclusion. This is the sequence which we should go and read the field. Look at each and every parameter carefully. Always look at the reliability parameters and try to find out the cause for the unreliability. For example, in this picture, we can see there are high amount of fixation loss. But look at the gaze tracking. There are highly, I mean, this is a good fixation. There are less upward deflection seen in the gaze tracker. This means this is a pseudo fixation loss, which happens because of the improper mapping of the blind spot. And in this case, it was the head tilt of the patient. Look for the causes of high false positive and high false negative. If the patient is getting tired early, so before doing for the next field, we can ask the patient to take some refreshment, or we can also tell the patient that in between the test, if you are getting tired quickly, you can pause the test by pressing the button and take a brief break and release the button once you want to start the test again. The eye only sees what the mind is prepared to comprehend. So once we look at this first picture at a glance, and we will think because the pattern deviation plot is clear, this may not be a glaucoma, but this is not true. When we look at the clinical picture, this is the picture of a advanced glaucomatous field effect. So we should look at each and every parameter and not to jump to the conclusion. In advanced field, most of the points have zero threshold. A very few have sensitivity. So under these condition, statistical assumption underlying the pattern deviation plots are not fulfilled. That's why the pattern deviation plot is empty. So look for the global indices, look whether the foveal threshold is correlating with the visual acuity. And when you find an advanced glaucomatous field, ask for a 10-2 and a macular program to look for the split macula if you are preparing for a surgery to look for the prognosis. Lack of understanding of the criteria and correlation of the disease, whether it is following the Anderson's criteria for early glaucomatous defect or whether RP-MIL criteria for early neurological field. Keep in mind the thumb rule that the glaucomatous field defect respects the horizontal meridian and the neurological field defect respects the vertical meridian. Don't miss out on the masquerades. Okay, once we look at this picture and there are depressed sensitivity inferiorly, we may think it is because of the superior rim defect seen clinically, superior rim thinning seen clinically, but it can be the picture of the clinical picture shown in the figure, that it can be because of the scatter laser superiorly, or it can be because of the superior optic disc coloboma or disc drusens. So keep all these DDs in mind and keep the masquerades in mind when we are diagnosing the glaucoma. Follow-up is important for looking at the progression of the disease. Look for the deterioration in two consecutive fields before changing the line of treatment. Before escalating the treatment, determine if the rate of progression will affect the visual function and quality of life. Most of the times, machine will automatically take the baseline perimetry as the first two reliable fields. But in case of GPA, if you want to select the field manually, avoid using those fields which are 6 to 12 months apart. Don't overlook the overview. And whenever the line of management, for example, surgery is changed, create a new baseline perimetry on the basis of present field for future comparison. So the take-home messages are, instruct the patient clearly, the need of the test, the procedure, have a team approach, because the reliability depends on how well the patient understood the test and how comfortable he was while doing the test. Request a correct perimetric protocol, do not diagnose a defect on just one field, and read it systematically, do not miss out on masquerades, and visual field should be done several times in the first 2 years after diagnosis to monitor the progression rate. Whenever line of management is changed, create a new baseline. Last but not the least, correlate the visual findings clinically after complete dilated retinal examination. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jhori. Our next speaker is Dr. Ganesh Raman, who is going to talk to us about the possible mistakes when we look at the optic disc and try to image the retinal nerve fiber layer. While Dr. Raman shares his slides, let me just come back and remind that the discussion is all towards the end, and send in your questions to us so that the moderators can take care of those questions. Dr. Raman.
Thank you, sir. So I'll be speaking to you on top 10 mistakes to avoid in optic nerve head and RNFL imaging.
Ganesh, can you come closer to the mic a little so that the volume is a little better?
Yeah, and I'm not able to forward my slides.
Bageshwar?
Okay, yeah, I think we are on, yeah. So OCT for glaucoma is the most commonly used imaging device, and more so because it's for mild and glaucomas and glaucoma suspects, it's one of the recommendations. So we have to understand it takes time to become familiar with the technology and also understand the pearls and pitfalls of any technology which we use. So the factors, errors which can occur are basically human related and machine related, which make an effect on interpreting the OCT scan, so to say. So for example, in this image on your left hand side, if you see, the right eye has been scanned twice. It's been scanned for the left eye also. So such a thing was found out, and then we re-scanned it. So all these issues can occur because of operator errors. So once we repeated it, you get a better baseline. Smudging of the lens is another issue. So if you have a smudging on the lens, you get black spots like this, and they can always pull down your average RNFL values and also affect your baseline. So once you clean the lens and repeat the scan, you find that you see a better picture on your, which is showing on your right hand side. So signal strength is another important aspect which you have to consider. Reduced signal strength results in a thin RNFL, and reduced signal strength can be because of device malfunction, poor patient cooperation, poor scanning technique of the operator. In Zeiss device, for example, the signal strength should be better than 7. The range is from 1 to 10. So you get out of 7 out of 10, 8 out of 10, something like that. And in Spectralis, the quality score should be considered and should be better than 20. The range is 1 to 40. So motion artifacts are important. You have usually patients with a microsecond, that's about 5 per second. And active tracking in the devices eliminates the motion artifacts. And because the scan time is, image acquisition time is very fast, so the idea is to reduce the motion artifacts. And motion artifact, how do you identify them is that you identify that vessel discontinuity. And may even occur even if the signal strength is very good. So for example, in this image, you will see that the signal strength is 10 out of 10. But if you look at the motion artifact, it's present in the right eye as well as the left eye. So you find that as a break in the continuity of the vessel. And this is again a very good image, very high scans quality, but you find that there are motion artifacts which are shown by the arrows here. Segmentation is another problem. So segmentation is that the machine is not able to differentiate layers of the retina properly. So if it can occur in high myopes, high hyperopes,
Ganesh, myelinate and I'm sorry to interrupt. Can you come closer to the mic?
Yeah, okay. Is this better, sir? So yes. Myelinated nerve fibers, tilted disc, peripapillary atrophy, usual causes are usually anatomical variations. So for example, in this image, if you see, you have a peripapillary atrophy here, but the OCT is not able to resolve the condition. And you get a something like a deep RNFL sort of a loss here, which is shown in the RNFL thickness map. And then if you see the tomogram, circular tomogram in the bottom right, you find that there is a the machine is not able to identify the segments properly. And image like this, you know, definitely a no-no for a OCT evaluation. You have to follow these patients on disc examinations. So if you were to scan them, you will find that there's a, in the circular tomogram, total segmentation differentiation is not at all possible in either eye. So scan alignment or centration, these are most common causes of the so-called red disease. That means the patient doesn't have the condition, but because of the scan misalignment, you find that there is a, the machine shows you a RNFL defect in the red area quite extensively. This is another image in which we purposefully decentered the circle, and you find that you have defects which are shown in the bottom left. And when you recenter it, and then you find that the patient is actually a normal output according to the age match of the particular profile of the patient. So media opacities like cataract, astigmatic hidrosis, posterior capsular opacification, ocular surface disease, vitreous hemorrhage, all these can also play truant when you are using the OCT. For example, astigmatic hidrosis, in this image on your left hand side, the patient has astigmatic hidrosis in their right eye where their left eye is normal. And if you were to do the OCT scan, you'll find that the segmentation and the quality of the scan is not very good. The signal strength is only 4 out of 10. So you won't be able to interpret it. The margin of error is quite high, and also the confidence interval for differentiation for progression is very, very wide. So coexisting pathology like Burge Mises papilla can put you as a, you know, falsely green disease. So patient in the circular tomogram on the right side, if you see, this is the circular tomogram, you find that the superior area shows as artifactually thickened retinal nerve fiber layer, but actually it is not so. If you were to look at the fundus image, you'll find that there is a superior neuroretinal rim loss as well. Epiretinal membranes, there's a small area of epiretinal membrane just temporal to the disc, and this is picked up very nicely. If you were to look for it, you'll find that it was picked up very nicely in the thickness Tisnet graph, the left eye shows a higher, thicker temporal RNFLs compared to the right eye. So unless you are looking for it, you won't be able to find it. Disc edema, retinal edema, again, they'll show you a supranormal values. And the last thing which you really have to think is structure and function correlation. For example, in this, you have a slit defects on the right, on the left side, on the superior aspect, as my pointer is showing you, you have a slit defect, which corresponds to the yellow demarcated area on the visual field. Rest of the scotomas which are present actually are not correlated with the structure. So it's actually a rim defect which you have. So top 10 steps which you have to take into account is good history taking and clinical examination. Get a good quality fundus photograph first. Factor in the operator error and other patient related factors like dry eyes, media opacities. Make note of coexisting pathologies. Good quality scan with good signal strength, centration, and alignment is a must. Review the scan and re-examine the patient to correlate clinically. Compare visual fields and imaging for structure and function correlation and look out for red and green disease. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Raman. Is diagnosing glaucoma all about a history taking, an intraocular pressure, an optic disc, gonioscopy, or imaging using advanced imaging techniques? There's more to it. And how not to make mistakes, our next speaker is Dr. Patyal, who is going to talk to us about how to avoid making mistakes when it comes to diagnosing glaucomas. Dr. Patyal, can you share your slides, please? Bageshwar?
Sorry, I had not unmuted myself. I'm going to talk about what are the mistakes that we are liable to make in diagnosing glaucoma. Am I audible?
Can I just interrupt you? Your slides have not come on.
Have you shared your slides?
Okay.
Bageshwar, can you get the slides on?
Yes.
Yeah. Have they come out now? Yes?
No, ma'am. No.
I have shared it.
No, Sagarika, go on the top screen. Not yet come.
Bageshwar?
Yes, sir.
Slides?
Top of the screen?
Yeah. I have gone on to share screen.
Yes.
PowerPoint. Has it come now, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I'm sorry. I do not know. Something must have happened. I'll go straight into my talk. And that is, since everything has been discussed, we'll discuss something about cases. Sorry, there's something not going on. Okay. So we had a 51-year-old male who came just with a complaint of frequent change of glasses. He was found to have posterior subcapsular cataract, his IOPs were found to be normal, his CCT was normal, and when the fields were done, they were the doctors at that time, they found certain defects, and this was how the optic discs looked like. However, the doctors at that time, they started him on Travitan, and this was in February of 2015. He came for reassessment in November 2015, where we found that his vision was quite all right. He hardly had any hypermetropia. His pachys were normal, his AT was normal, and his diurnal variation, which is so important in our diagnosis of glaucoma, was also absolutely normal, 8 to 10 right eye and 10 to 12 in the left eye. Pupils were equal in size and reaction, which is again very important. Gonioscopy was open angle. Of course, he had a little bit of posterior subcapsular cataract, and the retina, he had no signs of intermediate uveitis. He had no family history of glaucoma. He was not diabetic, neither was he hypertensive or diabetic, and therefore he had no risk factors. So on re-examination and reassessment, we found that his fields were absolutely normal. He had large physiological optic cups. There were no field defects. So the first thing that we have to remember is what has already been told by the earlier speaker, and that is when you have large optic discs, They may have large optic cups. So avoid labeling them as glaucoma because you just should not start treatment with drugs which may have so many side effects. My second case is a 79-year-old male who was diagnosed as a case of primary open-angle glaucoma. He states that his intraocular pressure was 17 to 18 millimeter of mercury prior to starting of anti-glaucoma medicines. He was, by the concerned doctor, prescribed timolol eye drops 0.5% both eyes. Later on, for whatever reason, the doctor added latanoprost. Then, in the left eye, looking probably at the fields, he underwent a trabeculectomy in July of 2012. Further, he underwent an Ahmed glaucoma valve implanted in 2013. Post AGV, he was put on Travacom and both the eyes were pseudophakic. I have shown you over here in the right eye and the left eye the fields of 2014, and you find that there is a central field defect both in the right eye, but mainly in the left eye, what I have marked out in red. And then in 2017, when the fields were again repeated, we find that the field defects have only increased in the central part. And so we said, is this really glaucoma? And we went ahead and did a VEP. Now, VEPs can be abnormal in glaucoma too, but we have to correlate whether central field defects are the first defects that we see in glaucoma, or are they because of some other optic neuropathies, for example, like optic neuritis, which he may have had. And we find that in the left eye, VEP was definitely abnormal in comparison to the right eye. So you have to reconsider your diagnosis if you see only central field defects. My third patient, as you can see in the picture, he is a case of a young man who was a case of thyroid ophthalmopathy. His exophthalmometry revealed that his right eye was 24 millimeter and 25 millimeter in the left eye at 110 millimeters. He was already put on anti-glaucoma drugs and he was referred for a glaucoma consultation. And I had the right eye field, which has not been shown, as I was absolutely normal. But in the left eye, both the 24-2 as well as the 10-2 revealed a complete hemifield defect. And if you look at the optic discs, you find that the right eye was looking normal with approximately a slightly larger cup. But if you look at the left eye, not only was the cup very large, the neuroretinal rim was extremely narrow superiorly, and the cup was very deep, which cannot be seen in the picture, but it was very deep and very large. Now, is this field defect which we are seeing and the optic nerve head defect because of glaucoma, or is it because of some other disease? Again, we took help of P100 latency and we found in the left eye it was definitely abnormal, 161.25 m in the left eye in comparison to the right eye. Therefore, if you see hemifield defects, remember that they can be because of AION, and systemic diseases are, like for example thyroid ophthalmopathy, are associated with AION, and that should be kept in mind. My next patient was a 47-year-old male who complained of pain and redness about 4 years ago to the concerned hospital. He was diagnosed as a case of primary angle closure glaucoma and he underwent YAG laser iridotomy in both the eyes and was started on premolitin. But he complained of persistent redness, and that was mainly in the right eye. He was a myope. His vision was improving to 6x6. Approximately, he had a myopia of -7 in both the eyes. His pressures were normal. Now, I'd like you all to have a look at the pictures of the right eye and the left eye. In the right eye, you can see there were tortuous convoluted blood vessels, episcleral vessels, enlargement of which has been shown out here and pointed out by the arrow. And along with that, when I did a gonioscopy, I found that there was blood also in Schlemm's canal. Whereas in the left eye, you can see the episcleral vessels. We find there was hardline, which is normal episcleral vessels, and the gonioscopy was absolutely normal. Along with that, when we had a look at the fundi, we find that the color of the fundi and the retinal background of the right and left eyes were grossly different. In the right eye, there was a bright red glow, whereas in the left eye, it was normal. And so, when we did the OCT, we found the swept source OCT, the choroidal thickness was 593 microns, and in comparison to the choroidal thickness of 230 microns in the left eye. And when we had a more thorough look, we found that he had a small port wine stain on the middle aspect of the right eyebrow in comparison to the other. He didn't have any. So this was a case of unilateral Sturge-Weber syndrome. And in this, I would definitely recommend, do not forget examination of the adnexa, which may hold clues. Next one is a 46-year-old male who complained.
Before you start this, can I request, can we wrap up in 30 seconds?
Okay, so I'll not be able to because I have had too many.
You finish this example. Examples. Finish this example and that.
All right. So this man, he complained of blurring of vision. He had 6/6 vision, but his pressures were extremely high. What was missed over here was the protrusions of the iris morphology, which is extremely important, protrusion and humps. Anterior chamber depth was extremely shallow. And in a UBM, we found that there were cysts of various sizes. So my fifth point is that the patient's iris morphology and pattern of iris and pupils should not be missed. I'll just tell about the various signs which should not be missed. And that is in a case of Weill-Marchesani syndrome. We must not forget that a person's lens insertion morphology should not be forgotten in the examination. Along with that, we must not forget in a very young patient not to look just at the optic disc, but please have a look at the macula. You may have Best disease, and these are unusual cases which should not be missed. Along with that, you might have signs of inflammation like a VKH in a young patient. This person should not be missed because of we have forgotten to examine for examination of the shallow anterior chamber, raised IOP, and signs of inflammation. Again, a person who has got varied clinical signs, we must try to correlate them in order to give the correct diagnosis. And lastly, in a patient, a person, young man who came with an acute lymphoblastic leukemia, he presented with uveitis with secondary glaucoma. He had bumps and protrusions of the iris. He had exudates and along with that hyperpeon. And we cannot afford to miss these signs and send the patient to the correct specialist. So because it was, in our case, a relapse of acute lymphoblastic leukemia and it can be life-saving for the patient. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Patel. And our next speaker is going to tell us about the mistakes that can be made when we start patients on treatment for glaucoma. Dr. Dipanjan Pal, can you share your slides, please? Dipanjan?
Can you see the slides, sir?
Yeah, we can see them, Dipanjan. Please start.
So, my job is to summarize basically top 10 mistakes in starting medical therapy in glaucoma. The decision to start medical therapy is crucial. As the therapy is lifelong, there is significant cost involvement. The commonest mistake that we see that there is a tendency to treat a single high intraocular pressure.
Dipanjan, can you come closer to the mic, please? Can you come closer to the mic?
Okay. Is it fine? Is it fine, sir? Is it fine? Yeah. Is it fine, sir?
Yes, it is. Please start.
So the commonest mistake that we face is a tendency to treat single high IOP reading. We should measure at least 2 to 3 for the baseline peak IOP, preferably on different locations and timings of the day, and corroborate them with the structural alterations, and also look carefully at the risk factors. The central corneal thickness measurement is often missed in the prescription. As we know that if there are thicker corneas, there is false diagnosis of ocular hypertension, and thinner cornea, there is chance of. And which we need to remember that the eyes with corneal defective surgery will have erroneously low IOP, and elevated intraocular pressure in post-resect eyes is starting treatment with non-contact dometry values is a big no. Goldman acquisition dometry is a good. As we know that the NCT is erroneous outside the normal. Please remember to use quaternary nitro. Never start a treatment of glaucoma without cornioscopy, because as we know, the primary opening with glaucoma is the area values of exclusion. A positive hand headache still requires a bronchoscopy, and a negative hand headache does not rule out the thing. And we not only miss the chance of diagnosing an angioplasia disease, but also miss the chance of reversing at least 66% of subacute primary angle closure after a single laser PI, who also presents with sporadic high intraocular pressure. IPJ is not a cancer.
Slide's not moving, Dipanjan?
No, it's not moving. What is happening?
Try once more. No? Bageshwar? Panjan, can you go on without the slides?
Yeah.
The slides are playing at your end on your screen, so please continue.
No, they are not playing in my screen also. Now it's... Shall I stop share and share again?
Try it once more. So what we'll do is we'll go on to the next speaker, Professor.
Why don't you go for the backup slides? Backup. Use the backup, please.
Bageshwar?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Can we use the backup slide?
So I should stop sharing.
So what we do is,
I think it has come, sir.
Okay. Carry on.
So the next common mistake is starting treatment with single visual field report. That should be avoided. We should please repeat, because a single repeat clears up most of the scotomas, and we should definitely look at the reliability indices. And glaucoma mimicking conditions are to be carefully looked into. Don't start treatment without just observe them over a period of time, because starting therapy in a pale disc is not very common now, but still, this is an old patient of mine who presented to us. The left eye is with a profound disc pallor a few years back, and the diagnosis was normal tissue glaucoma. And when he was on three medications, and the visual field revealed bitemporal hemianopia. And interestingly, the person was carrying old visual field report, which was probably not read, and it was also showing visual field respecting cortical midline. And the obvious diagnosis was pituitary adenoma. Also should remember, not only these chiasmatic and pre-chiasmatic conditions, glaucoma interestingly shares characteristic features with many other anterior optic neuropathies, like anterior ischemic optic neuropathy. And the differentiating points are all these diseases, they have a profound afferent pupil defect, central acuity and color vision, and definitely a pallor of the preserved rim, and characteristic visual field defects like central scope. Over reliance on imaging, we should just give an example that this 62-year-old lady who was on lateral crossed once daily both eyes for 2 years just because he had an asymmetric cupping and some changes in the infratemporal region to an imaging technique. And interestingly, the visual field was not done, which we did, and we found superior corticopia, and the diagnosis was a benign classification of basal ganglia. Start treatment only based on imaging. We still have a prescription where we see that the physician has started with multiple topical neither the efficacy nor the adverse effect of each of these medicines can be judged. So we always should start with a monotherapy, and if required, we can add oral amounts for this. The primary prescription should have but with maximum efficacy and minimum dose, we should avoid beta blockers in avoid alpha-adrenergic agonists in elderly population, and please write potassium supplements the moment you are giving oral dialogues. While additional molecules, just remember, the synergistic effect if we are starting with the postnatal detection. That is, that increases uterus neuron flow. So it should be added either with a beta blocker or carbonic anhydrous inhibitor topical one, which decreases excess production. Avoid adding oral carbonic oral diamonds with topical ACAIs because they actually do not give any extra intraocular pressure benefit. And addition of 4.5 drug over a 3-drug regime is actually decrease the compliance. Also remember that the single night dose of beta blocker is of no use. Beta blocker doesn't have and it actually decreases optic nerve. Please avoid multiple postnatal anhydrous. Topical carbonic anhydrous inhibitors works best in 3 times daily dosage if prescribed alone. And if we have to give beta blocker along with postnatal block, the best to take time is morning hours. For more common algorithm mistakes in the management of glaucoma, please refer to Dr. Dorin Naik sir's this function from Journal of Corneal, sorry, Journal of Clinical Ophthalmology. At the end, I will just look what an ideal prescription should look like. We should follow the rule of 5 R's, that is right patient, right drug, right dose, right route, and right time. This is a proper prescription. This is for Mr. Rovinash Paul. His age is 56 years. His address is properly written. In the advice, the drug name is properly written. And we should not write IDROP, that is eye drops. So do not write abbreviations. We should not write BE, that is both eyes. We should write both eyes. And the right timing, that's the bedtime. Right route, that is locally. Then the right period of the drug application, that is for 6 months, and we should write the follow-up advice properly, that is to follow up for 3 months, and please mention to continue the medicine in next follow-up, and at the end you sign, you write your name properly with your phone number and registration number. So to conclude, do not initiate therapy based on either intraocular pressure, visual field defect, or these findings alone. Take adequate time to establish your diagnosis. Write proper legible prescriptions and ensure chair time to increase compliance and adherence. Thank you for your patient hearing. Stay safe. Stay on.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Deepanjan. And our last speaker for today, and after this speaker, we're going to have our question answer session. Our next speaker is Professor Kirti Singh, and I would request Bageshwar if you can share the slides for her, please. And she's going to talk to us about how to make sure we don't
Dr. Dhurinder, I will be sharing my slides. It was just a backup plan. Is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you for this talk and the invite. Thank you all. So, decision to perform trabeculectomy, avoid 10 mistakes. These are the 10 commandments told by the GSI, so which I'm going to try to talk about. So that depends. The 10 commandments are, it depends on the type of glaucoma, which can be ACG, OAG, and secondary glaucoma. These three I'll be covering. ACG situations, we all know that crystalline lens is pivotal for the angle crowding, and early lens removal in mild and moderate cataractous lenses arrests PACG disease. Is it visible, please?
Bageshwar,
am I visible?
Bageshwar, can you run the backup slides, please?
Oh, don't run the backup slides. Is it visible?
Yes, it's visible now. Visible.
Yeah, perfectly already. So, crystalline lens is pivotal for the angle crowding, and Eagle study has told us all that. But let's talk about cataractous lens, which can arrest PACG disease. That effect of trabeculectomy over years will decline. Therefore, cataract surgery in these situations is able to buy time. And this study of ours. This study of ours in 40 patients over 6 months follow-up showed IOP control, good intraocular pressure control, and sustained control of IOP. Requirement of anti-glaucoma medications was reduced. However, we did have 5% failures, which required trabeculectomy. This is the prototype of preoperative and postoperative pictures of the angle opening out. Best thing was that the visual field indices in these patients improved. Therefore, the first commandment is that in ACG lens, which is ACG eyes with bulky lens, phaco can be tried first and trab later. Second is for secondary glaucomas, especially uveitic, steroid-induced and traumatic. Just controlling the pathology itself would control the glaucoma and intraocular pressure. Like in these studies, where steroid-induced glaucoma and traumatic glaucoma respectively were only 19% and 37% required trab. Especially in pseudoexfoliation glaucoma, again, lens management alone will flatten the diagonal curve and control IOP. Therefore, my second commandment is avoid unnecessary trabeculectomies in secondary glaucoma. Third, in POAG situations, lens surgery alone may significantly reduce the anti-glaucoma requirement, medication requirement, and control the IOP because cataractous lens displaces the uveal tract anteriorly and compresses Schlemm's canal and reduces outflow. Post-phacoemulsification, matrix metalloproteinases also have the effect on trabecular meshwork. Both of these aspects increase the outflow, and studies have shown up to a 6.5% reduction over 5 years. And this recent survey by the American Glaucoma Society said that for patients with early cataract and POAG, 44% people just preferred a phaco, and 22% microinvasive, and TAB was down by 24% in the combined surgery. Therefore, in visually significant cataract, in POG situations, prior phacoemulsification alone, because in mild to moderate glaucoma, you avoid the morbidity of TAB. This is a new word which I found, avoid a bleb for life. And bleb dysthesias, we know about bleb dysthesias of tear film disruption, ptosis, infection, limitation of activities as told by Sijits. So basically, you want to avoid all these, and especially in mild or moderate, you can get away with the phacoemulsification alone. Please remember, SICS, which is a conjunctival incision surgery, causes priming of congenital fibroblasts, and this surgery, if it is done, then later on the TRAB success can reduce by 60%. So the next commandment is, in mild to moderate OAG, avoid a bleb for life, try phaco and not SICS, and do a combine later on. Next one is the big buzzword, the MIGS or the minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. They have a high safety profile. It's an ab internal approach. It targets a diseased trabecular meshwork. However, efficacy is less. Again, it causes a bleb-free environment. It can be incorporated into phacoemulsification with faster visual rehab. And cost, however, cost is an issue. Therefore, do not do this surgery if you want a low target IOP, because the efficacy is not so high. Please remember, these many studies of MIGS, the literature is full of them. Let's just read the end, because between the lines, if you read, many of these studies are driven by industry. So take it with a pinch of salt. So the fourth commandment is that in mild to moderate glaucoma, MIGS is an option with and without phaco. However, sitting in India may not be, because cost is an issue. Next is advanced glaucoma with macular split issues. Please do pre-ploy sutures, side port creation, slow decompression, releasable sutures, bleb titration. All these will avoid snuff out syndrome. Therefore, in the fifth commandment of thou shalt not kill, avoid snuff out. POAG with high IOP not controlled despite maximal medical therapy, including systemic and dazolamide, you can have ODR, malignant glaucoma. We have done in our center DLCP in those patients just to buy time again in the inferior quadrants, and we found that by 1 month, most of the patients were controlled, and then subsequently we did a trial in a quieter milieu. Therefore, avoid operating on angry glaucoma. The seventh commandment is that when you do a combined surgery and not a trial alone, in early to moderate glaucoma with patients who require more than three medications, older patients, it's a better option, especially both comorbidities are handled at once, in one go, with patients poor access to medical care. It's cost saving and quality of life is reduced because the requirement for AGM is less. Please remember, in our country, many patients are below poverty line, and 70% ophthalmologists are in urban areas where only 23% of the population lives. So combined surgery with the presence of cataract and glaucoma is a very good option for patients. With cataract, it can be a confounder, and knowing that cataract would worsen control of IOP if you do a TRAB first, trabeclectomy alone would accelerate cataract progression as told by multiple studies including AGES. However, telling all these points, in combined surgery, effectivity is less vis-a-vis TRAB alone. So do not shirk from doing a combined surgery wherever required for these patients. In normal tension glaucoma scenarios, please remember low ocular pressure, ocular perfusion pressure is an independent risk factor, and look for sleep apnea, look for ocular perfusion pressure, do rule out vascular dysregulation, and do not be trigger happy to do a TRAB so fast in a progressive NTG unless you've ruled out this ocular perfusion pressure aspects. Patient counseling. Trabeclectomy is a surgery in which cataract would improve, would increase in both the intensity, and many patients require a cataract surgery. So while doing a TRAB, explain the need for a second surgery of cataract. Explain that this will cause visual consolidation and not a gain. Explain the requirement for a lifetime follow-up and be realistic. Stagger your TRAB to nasal side. Leave the superior and temporal area free for second surgery. So my ninth commandment is that thou shalt ensure while counseling that the patient does not have unrealistic expectations during TRAB. The last commandment is do not be wary of doing a TRAB despite bleb issues. Yes, you give a bleb for life, but trabeclectomy has been a time tried and tested surgery since 1968. It's been ruling supreme. And please remember, when we keep doing excessive anti-glaucoma drugs, they're all pro-fibrotic. And this conjunctiva doesn't remain virgin anymore. The scarring of the TRAB, which has to be ultimately done, will be much more. So do not procrastinate. And I beg to differ with Sijic, which says that quality of life was better with anti-glaucoma eradication. For my patient profile, quality of life is better with a TRAB vis-a-vis anti-glaucoma medication. So my last commandment is, thou shalt trust in your potential as a surgeon and do not procrastinate for a trabeclectomy. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Singh. Before I actually hand over to Dr. Devendulli and Dr. Aluwalia, I think, you know, glaucoma is a disease which is very interesting. As much as it is difficult to manage, the important thing to remember is that everyone knows something, but nobody knows everything. And we have had 10 speakers today. Each one of them has pointed out 10 important things to avoid so that you don't make mistakes. So that's 100 take-home messages today that have already been transferred to you to avoid in a day-to-day practice. I would now request Dr. Devendulli and Dr. Aluwalia to take this forward.
And Dr. Devendra, we increased by question answer by 10 minutes. So 15 minutes question answer left over. After that, you can take over if you want 2-3 minutes extra. So 15 minutes.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Right, thank you. Navjot, I'll ask the first one and then you can do the second. So going in the sequence of how we receive the questions, I'm going to slightly modify the pattern because some have asked for didactic lectures type, they asked for lectures for glaucoma. So first question for the patient. Hello?
Yes,
Navjot.
Yes,
Navjot. Dipanjan, laser trabeculoplasty as the first treatment.
Laser trabeculoplasty is the first treatment.
Yes.
I would prefer. I would prefer laser trabeculoplasty as a first treatment. I will only reserve it.
Mistake?
Sorry? Is it a mistake? Needs to be closer to you.
So nothing is a mistake in glaucoma. We should have every gun in our army. But laser trabeculoplasty is definitely, I don't think laser trabeculoplasty should be tried over contraception. Unless in some situations like pregnancy where you have to buy time and because of
the answer is it should be not the first choice treatment and can be used in select cases like you said in pregnancy. Navjot, you can do the second.
My question to Dr. Mayuri is, I just want to ask her, like, what system she is following while documenting the findings on gonioscopy, because many times we write 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 as the structures we see. And the classification varies from person to person which he is using, but we are not mentioning the type of classification on gonioscopy. We are just writing 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So I just want to ask Dr. Mayuri, what is your view on that?
I used to write down which is the posterior. Hello? Can I answer now?
Yes, ma'am, please.
I write the posterior structure that I can see in that particular quadrant. So suppose I see the sclerospore, I write down SS in that particular quadrant. Secondly, if any abnormal thing is visible, like the PAS or the blood vessel or the patchy of pigments, something like that, then I put it exactly in that o'clock so that I know where the abnormal structures or the thing is. I don't follow one particular classification. This is the better way of judging.
So you are not following a classification, but you are doing it on the posterior most structure seen.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
And I also note down the what is the convexity or the shape of the last roll of the iris, flat, concave or convex.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. I think the next question from the audience is from Dr. Madhu Badoria. Ma'am, you had mentioned about yoga. So there are 2-3 questions which have come from the audience. Is it a mistake for a glaucoma patient to do even pranayama?
No, it's not a mistake. Only yogas in which your head goes down below the waist. If it's not going there, then all the yogas are actually permissible. They are good. In fact, they're actually walking and yoga improve your intraocular pressures. It's an evidence-based by Tanush Dada that only those where the head is really going down. Below the waist means your abdominal pressure is rising. And when that is rising, it's causing raised IOP as well.
Thank you. Navjot, yours, the next one from the audience.
Hello, this is my question to Dr. Madhu, ma'am. I just want to ask you, ma'am, how often do you take the history of kidney disease before when we are initiating, like when you are taking a history, how often do you ask questions about any kidney problems, because we have to give acetazolamide or mannitol to these patients, and many of times we have found that patients are on either on hemodialysis or sometimes they even have anuria. So how often do you find that this history is very, very important in the management of glaucoma?
In mannitol, it's always 100% you have to ask. If you have to give oral Dimox, even then it has to be taken mandatorily. But for giving topical COI inhibitors, it's not really required, because other systemic diseases are so many. Kidney diseases are not so much. The association, as per the evidence-based 10,000 patients in survey, has shown that kidney disease comes in less than 1% patients. So therefore, it is not for all the patients. But any time you have to give oral or IV any medication to the patient, it is required.
Yeah. So, ma'am, one more question is, do you ask for the kidney function test when you are giving a tablet acetazolamide or IV mannitol?
IV mannitol, truly speaking, is always an emergency. So therefore, if this can be done within the in-house, that we have a lab actually. So we always do it ECG, and that's another required thing is because the heart function could also be, but ECG and kidney function test are mandatory for this. But for Dimox, other than doing kidney function test, I would also do a blood profile, because blood dyscrasia is another very common problem which we don't know really. If the death is caused in a patient with Dimox, it's blood dyscrasia.
Thank you, ma'am. I'll take two next questions from the audience. Medha, for you, isn't rule. So, is it a mistake always to follow, or can a doctor go wrong in following the isn't rule? Yeah. To answer that.
Question. Can you repeat it?
So the question is, in isn't rule following that, can a doctor make mistake in following the isn't rule?
Have you put the question? Dr. Medha is not there, so I can answer that question, that the isn't rule can be intact and the patient can still have glaucoma, and this would be seen in about 25% of cases. And similarly, the isn't rule may not be followed, that is, the inferior rim may be narrower, and in about 24 to 25% of patients, the patient need not have glaucoma. The other thing to remember is that the isn't rule has been worked out for optic discs which are vertically oval and not for horizontal optic discs. And some people may question it, saying that it has not been worked out in an Indian population. So it's Caucasian data that has been used to look at this. I think it's Werner in 1969 from Philadelphia. But the important thing here is the isn't rule need not be followed for glaucoma. But yes, we need to take that into account when we're looking at the glaucoma characteristics. Devin?
Hello. Yeah. Can I take the next question, sir? Yeah. So my question, this is my question from one of the audience, and they have asked, like, what is the minimum distance visual acuity to perform a Humphrey visual field? So this is my question to Dr. Roma, if she's there.
Yeah. What is the minimum distance?
What is the minimum distance visual acuity to perform a Humphrey visual field testing?
Okay, so they want to know what is the minimum vision to do a visual field. Visual field can be done on Humphreys even till 2x60 or 1x60. But if the patient is not able to see the fixation target, we can increase the size of the target. Because it's a near target, so we need not have a, 618, 630. Even by 1x60, 2x60 also we can do. Patient should be able to see the target. If he is not able to see the target, we have to increase the size of the target.
So the next question, I think I'll request Nayak sir to answer this. Sir, what is the correct time to use a prostaglandin-timolol combination? Is it a mistake ever to use it in the morning or the night? Nayak sir?
No, basically means always there are conflicting reports which is there in literature. But if you ask me, because I see there is no reason why we should not miss, we should use it in the morning. So if it is combination, I prefer personally use it in the morning, because beta blockers at night is usually contraindicated, and it's a, so it's better that, because we are here, beta blocker is the guiding factor, deciding factor, rather than the prostaglandin. Because anyway, prostaglandin has effect around for 24 hours, so it doesn't make much difference, but beta blockers will. So this is my view.
Okay, so the next question is about, is it wrong to use a Rho kinase inhibitor in a narrow angle glaucoma? Sir, Sood sir, can you undertake that?
The question, Devin?
Is it wrong to use the Rho kinase inhibitors in narrow angle glaucoma?
So, Devin, I don't have much experience yet with Rho kinase inhibitors yet. In fact, I have only one patient who was on Rho kinase inhibitors when I last saw him. So why don't you put this question to somebody who's using this regularly?
Devin?
Yes, ma'am, please.
Yes, ma'am, please.
You can help me out with this.
Help me out with this.
I have not used Rho kinase, because when it was launched, uske baad we had this lockdown. But yes, I have done an extensive search on it. In angle closure glaucoma, it doesn't really work, because trabecular meshwork has to be open for it to have an effect on the trabecular outflow. It acts directly on the trabecular outflow. However, it does cause some amount of vasodilatation. So it is purported that it increases the ocular perfusion pressure and the optic disc nerve head, it increases the vascular flow. However, in ACG per se, it doesn't have much of a role.
Can I ask Dr. Patyal there to have a quick comment on this? Dr. Patyal, are you there?
Experience. Yeah, I don't have experience in this using this drug. So I'll not be able to comment.
No, anyone else would like to chip in?
Yeah, yeah, I'm Dr. Nayak. So I have experience using these drugs, and especially because I have come down to one thing, that in the post-operative patients, I prefer to use it only for one reason, because it also has some anti-inflammatory effect. So therefore, whenever I have to use either post-TRAP or post-cataract, if I have to use any anti-glaucoma medication, now this has become my first choice. But not as, otherwise, it is not the first or second line of medication. That one should be very sure about it.
So the next question, Dr. Manavdeep, can you take the next question? What about silicon oil glaucoma? What is the time when you remove the silicon oil? How much time will it take for the pressure to normalize, if it all has to, after removal of silicon oil?
In case the pressure has been high, you mean?
Obviously, it was silicon oil glaucoma. So, silicon oil glaucoma, it is
not essential that it will come down permanently. It can stay permanently high also. And
so the question was, after removal of silicon oil, if the pressure has to come down, how much time does it usually take?
Usually few weeks, 4 to 6 weeks.
Anyone else would from the panel would like to take this question? Dr. Sagrika?
Silicon oil induced glaucoma many months, and in fact, I have seen patients even years after, because the silicon oil goes long and blocks the trabecular meshwork. They may even require surgery, and if not, at least a YAG-PI, especially done inferiorly, if suppose there is blockage. So that is why these patients need to be followed up.
Silicon oil glaucoma, the pathogenesis is in the trabecular meshwork and intercanalicular area, where there is inflammation because of the silicon bubble. And so, even after removal of the silicon oil, patient may not respond or pressure may not go down. In that case, you have to do surgery, not only the silicon oil removal.
So, Dr. Devan, you know what happens is that the silicon oil emulsifies and it gets stuck in the trabecular meshwork. That's one part. The second part is that removal doesn't mean that the removal is 100%. So, those globules by itself can come and block the trabecular meshwork, as Dr. Khamar just pointed out. So there is no time period that you would actually say that I've done the removal and 3 to 6 weeks, things are going to settle down. That's unlikely to happen.
Yeah. So this question actually two or three people had asked. So I thought we'll spend some time on this. So Sood sir, you could do the last one also, because I think Medha is not there. So it's on disc, and one of the audience wants to know, a common mistake they face is papilledema or pseudopapilledema versus glaucoma disc.
So I think what you do is, Devin, put this question to Ramesh, because he hasn't answered a single question. So I think everyone would be involved in the group.
So sure. Ganesh, are you there?
Yeah, yeah. Can you repeat the question?
Medha is there.
Medha is there. I think her mic is on. But
so I think both of you can answer it. It's a clinical question.
Ganesh, you can answer first, because it's basically a situation from the audience where papilledema like disc appearance or the margin versus a glaucoma situation. What tips would you give to avoid errors?
I think papilledema is quite obvious compared to a optic disc. The disc margin is the defining.
Could you elaborate, Ganesh? We are short in time. Could you elaborate quickly for the audience?
No, papilledema is pretty obvious in the sense you have disc margin blurring, and then you have the disc, for example, in a normal or a glaucomatous feature. So I failed to understand how you would have a confusion, unless you have something like operative drusen or something like that. That is one thing which you can get confused with.
Yes, same, yeah. Actually, you cannot confuse papilledema with glaucomatous disc. It's totally apart. In the OCT or in any other evaluation, you will get thickened RNF.
So unless you are trying to push towards investigation, you know, unless you are trying to use a hi-fi device to get an investigation done.
Why not, Ganesh?
What for, sir? Yeah, you could. I mean, if you want to, if you are as biased in your clinic as possibly can be, you could.
We can pick up a question for Mayuri, ma'am. This is the question, the mistake probably, that why not use anterior segment OCT in lieu of gonioscopy?
Anterior segment OCT will not show you pigmentation, blood vessels, and it cannot give you 360 degree viewing. It's a segmental viewing. So gonioscopy is must. Anterior segment OCT, I am very much fond of. I am using lot of imaging, but it is an additional tool. And when gonioscopy is impossible to do, uncooperative patient, bad cornea, opaque cornea, in that case, you can use imaging.
Okay, one more question is regarding the surgery. Dr. Kirti is there, ma'am?
Dr. Yes, Kirti, ma'am, you go ahead and put the question. Go ahead and put the question.
The question is similar on the same lines as anterior segment OCT one, that why not do phaco always and not do YAKI at all?
In angle closure.
In angle closure, obviously, yes, sir.
Yeah.
They have not specified the spectrum of angle closure, but I think it's a broad question. So, ma'am, you would not do in your hospital, you don't do laser PI at all? Sir, would you like to take this question? Because, ma'am, I think ma'am's... Sudh, sir, can you answer this? Because ma'am's connection is poor.
So, you know, if I say something like this, there will be a bias. Because angle closure is not a single disease by itself, but it's a spectrum. So if the cataract is not significant, that would not be my first priority. And for me, all angle closure actually means a laser iridotomy first and not
I
the cataract surgery.
I think that's a message because you'll be happy to learn that we had questions also from Bangladesh and neighboring countries, not just from India. So I think the message we have to give is that these anterior segment OCT cannot replace gonioscopy. It's a supportive thing and laser PI. You cannot.
And
think
the laser
of, you know,
PI cannot be replaced with a phaco emulsification.
Absolutely. And also, one question from Manavdeep. For a lot of the. There are two, three questions on similar lines, so I'm kind of summarizing in one.
Can we make this the last set of questions, please?
Definitely the last question, sir. Anyway, it's the last question from the audience. Manavdeep is there or no?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, so the question is, two, three have come, so I'm kind of jumbling them in one, that a lot of the audience does not have access to apnenation, and they are using Schiotz or NCT only. So is it okay to manage their practice like that? Is it a mistake to manage it like that? Or they must seek apnenation from a neighboring doctor or a clinic?
Sir, these are basically screening tools. And anybody who can afford NCT, which costs a few lakh rupees, can always afford apnenation tonometer, which is 50,000-60,000 rupees. So anybody who has NCT must switch on to apnenation tonometry, at least for glaucoma patients. For screening in the OPD, shorts as well as NCT is acceptable to me. And those, if somebody cannot afford at all, or it is very far-flung areas, the apnenation is not possible, they don't have even slit lamp, under those circumstances, definitely they can continue with short tonometer.
So, I think the message is very clear that it's better to, in a glaucoma suspect, when you label, you have to do apnenation before proceeding to other things which have been talked about today. Because in a lot of situations, if you do apnenation, your patient may not remain a glaucoma suspect after that. Sudh sir, Nayak sir, could you please take over now?
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Thuli and Dr. Aluwalia, for that little thing. I think the message is very clear that the patient has to be seen in the proper perspective. And it's important that you take a good history. You do a good clinical examination, which should involve a slit lamp examination. Make sure that the corneal thickness has been taken, correlated with the intraocular pressure. You've looked at the Van Herricks. You've done a gonioscopy, you've done an examination under dilatation, and you arrive at a working diagnosis. Visual fields will help corroborate your diagnosis. And the newer imaging, though not essential for diagnosis, can be used to assess change over time, just as visual fields are also used over a period of time. So any final comments from anyone in the panel who wants to just make a quick remark, and then we could just close this meeting? So thank you very much, everyone. And this was the last seminar from the GSI. I just want to tell you that the GSI is going to go online for its annual meeting and for the elections. It's very important that you update your personal details on the website. Nobody can do this for you. You got to go there and do it yourself so that you are involved in the annual meeting of the GSI, which is going to be online this time. Dr. Nayak? Anything you'd like to add to this, please?
No, right now that is good, and because this is what that we expect from the all members, that they should
update their... Unmute yourself, please.
That they should continue, and they should update their whatever their latest mobile number and email IDs. I said for members it is only the updation right now, and I also thank Centis Pharma that for supporting this webinar, and I am sure that Centis Pharma will continue supporting our future whatever activities we are doing. But unfortunately the webinars, we are not doing it for the next 2 months. Then after that the new team will take over, and then whatever is the plan, it will be followed up.
So I'd like to thank all the speakers and Centis Pharma, Dr. Nayak, Dr. Manavdeep Singh, Dr. Deven Tulli and Dr. Aluwalia for an interesting session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.